Good morning and welcome to Madison Church. I'm so glad you joined us for worship this morning. And I hope you had a Merry Christmas. I'd love for you to tell me about your experience with your family and especially all the fun and crazy stuff that happened. I love those stories. So please tell me. This morning for announcements, I just want to make you aware of a couple things. First of all, is that there is a nursery available during the service. So if you've never been here before, then I want you to know that there you can send your kids 4 years old and younger downstairs and have somebody else deal with them for a while, which I think is fun. We, in 2018, set off on a plan to read the Bible together as a church in a year. And so if you've been following along with us and maybe have fallen behind a little bit, then you only have 2 days to finish. So if you're still in Exodus, then you've got a long ways to go. You might need some energy drinks to get through that. But I have had a lot of fun going through the Bible together with you this year and talking about it in Sunday school. We are going to keep the Bible reading plan going. And so in 2019, we'll revise the dates. And so I think reading the Bible through every year would be a great thing to do. It would be a great discipline to have as a believer. And so I encourage you to keep going our Bible reading plan. I can provide you with paper copies of the study notes if you want them, but we are not going to have them out in the lobby anymore for 2019. They'll be the same notes with different dates on them for the new dates for 2019. They will be available on our website for the 2019 dates. And if you would like me to provide a paper copy, then just get in touch with me and I can make sure you have those. And then finally, Madison Church is going to take meals for our community youth group that meets on Wednesday nights. And so there's a sign-up sheet for that in the lobby. We plan on having about 40 kids there, usually on Wednesday nights. And so if you would like to sign up to provide one of those meals on a Wednesday night in January, you can find a sign-up sheet for that in the lobby. And then finally, I'd like you guys to stand up together with me this morning as we read a passage to prepare to worship. As we sing this morning, we're going to sing an invitation with words for the faithful to come. And I want to read you a passage about that, a passage that I'll give you a spoiler and say that we'll return to later today. From Revelation chapter 22, starting verse 17, it says, "The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. Let the one who is thirsty come, and let the one who wishes take the free gift of the water of life."
Oh, As we come to prayer time this morning, I hope you all had a blessed Christmas season. Definitely brings up the reason why we all come here. So thankful that the Lord sent his son die for us. If you look in your bulletins for the prayer list there, I have an update and a couple more to add. I talked to Mary this morning, said Craig is continuing to improve with his ankle. So we continue to keep him in prayer and hope that the infection stays away. Also, we need to remember the family of Norma Hicks. This would be Mary Ellen Clayton's sister-in-law. She passed away last night. So be with the Clayton family and also the Hicks family. Also would like you to remember Gary Evans. He's my first cousin on my mom's side. He is going in on January 3rd to have a procedure on his head. He has a spot on his brain, pushing on his brain. They don't really know what it is, but they're going to go see. So it's in God's hands. So hopefully things turn out well there. Does anybody else have anything, prayers or praises to share? Joe. Okay.
Remember her family.
Okay, yeah. Remember the family of Millie Roth, be Joe's aunt, as she passed away this last day or two. Anybody else? I do know that there's a lot of people that are dealing with issues that they don't want shared, but just we all have stuff we struggle with or illnesses or diseases or things we fight. So just keep in prayer the congregation in general, and all your friends and family also that are dealing with stuff that we don't know about. So we'll go ahead and go to God in prayer, and I'll close. Almighty God, Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the blessings you've given us. We thank you for the opportunity to come and worship you. We thank you for the son that you gave. I ask that you be with the people that are on our list today and those that we don't know about. Give them strength when needed. Give them love and support. Let doctors heal. We thank you for all the blessings you've given. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
For criminals, away our sin. He takes away our sin. The Holy Lamb of God makes us alive again. Makes us alive again. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away our sin. Who takes away our sin. The Holy Lamb of God makes us alive again. Makes us alive again. Blood bled for me. Hold your blood in crimson streams. Hold your death is hell's defeat. A cross meant to kill is my victory. Hold your blood bled for me.
Father in heaven, we thank you for this day to come and worship you. As we take the Lord's Supper, let us examine ourselves, our lives, and our hearts, and repent when needed. We thank you for the blessings you've given. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
An ultimatum is a hard thing to be on the receiving end of. Have you ever been on the wrong side of one? Receiving an ultimatum from a friend, or worse, from your boss, or even worse, from your spouse, is a bad place to be. An ultimatum is a request which is accompanied by a threat. If that request is not met, then the threat will be. At work, this might sound like, if you don't do this, then you will need to leave. At home, it might sound like, if you don't do that, then I will leave. At the Nielsen's Sunday dinner after church, it often sounds like this. If you don't stop telling Randy Reed, go Hawkeyes, you will never eat another piece of candy again in your life. Ultimatums are not a kind way of speaking or interacting with someone. A wise counselor might encourage someone to use them less often or not at all. They might encourage a parent to instruct their children without them. They might encourage you to distance yourself from friends who use them too often. Usually it'd be much better for the speaker, the initiator, to have a certain amount of positional or relational capital so that a request can be made and considered and hopefully fulfilled without the threat of retaliation. Without the looming presence of backlash which has been spoken in an ultimatum. A boss should be able to make a request of an employee without threatening their job. Your spouse should be able to come to you in honesty and ask you for a change without the threat of retaliation, or worse, the threat to leave. And if things are really, really good, a parent should be able to instruct their child without, at the same time, threatening a punishment. But now I'm beginning to stretch the limits of credibility, aren't I? Just tell me if this sounds like it would work. Henry, please calmly and quietly eat all of the food on your plate, quickly and without leaving your chair, because you love me. No. That's not going to work. That never works. That's the way I should start. As a parent, this should be my opening offer. But I'll tell you what's going to happen. And I guess this is my excuse for often skipping that step, is because I believe that all the time the opening offer will be followed by sentences like, get that spaghetti out of your hair or you're going to your room. That's an ultimatum. Throw another piece of your food at your brother and it's spanking time. That's another ultimatum. You have 5 more minutes to finish your food or I'm taking away the tablet for 2 days. I use that one a lot. Those are ultimatums. And I have to use them because the other means of compulsion were unsuccessful. An ultimatum is or should be a sign of desperation. The last and ugliest option. We make them because we're desperate. Because we're sure or pretty sure that if we said it any other way, we wouldn't get what we asked for. Thus, there were no ultimatums in the Christmas story. It's not that desperate. Seriously, there are none. In the Christmas story, it is just simply and majestically the arrival of Jesus, God's Son who has come to rescue God's people and provide the long-awaited and desperately needed deliverance for God's people. Deliverance from evil and deliverance from death. That's what happened at Christmas. Recall what the angels proclaimed to the shepherds. There was no ultimatum. They said, don't be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. There's no threat there. This was a gift given to all people. It is purely and wholly good news. The arrival upon the earth of God's plan to redeem mankind. Upon this news, a host of angels proclaim glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth peace. That is a blessing with no threat. And no threat is made in the account of Jesus' arrival, be it in Matthew or Luke. But at the same time, as we have observed over the last couple of weeks, there is a darkness still present in the Christmas story. It is the backdrop for the arrival of light that is Jesus Christ. But you get a glimpse, even in the Christmas story, of a reality in which not everyone receives or accepts the light that Jesus Christ brings into the world. In Matthew, you have Herod's reaction to the arrival of Messiah, which was violence and murder. Jealousy. Recall that the angels stipulated their blessing. The host of angels didn't just say glory to God in the highest and on earth peace, but they stipulated peace to those on whom God's favor rests. And then, of course, recall the strange words from the Magnificat, the Song of Mary, in the presence of Elizabeth, which we examined 2 weeks ago. These lines, which appear out of place in our Christmas liturgy. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, and he has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but he has sent the rich away empty. Those words are part of the Christmas story. They're not an ultimatum, but in them we see brief flashes of the reality that the gift of Christmas will not be received by all. That while the children of God welcome Jesus as Savior and King, there are those for whom he will be or is a judge and a deliverer of wrath. Throughout this Christmas season, we've been using the book of Revelation, as I believe it was intended to serve as a way to explain the spiritual reality or implications of Christ's incarnation, work, and ascension. And when I call Revelation a series of spiritual realities, I don't mean to imply that they're less real than the kinds of truths that we experience here in the world, physical realities you might call them, but that they are more real. What we read in Revelation are visions belonging to a higher heavenly reality. And the promise of God's word is that this reality that we read about in Revelation will one day overtake, will one day snuff out the one we experience here. That reality will be victorious over this one. The timeline of heaven will obliterate the timeline of earth, and our God will reign forever. And in Revelation, we're ready to read the account of Christ's victory. We'll be in chapters 19 through 22 today if you want to open your Bible there. I'm going to start reading in Revelation chapter 19, starting in verse 11. There it says this, "I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and wages war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Coming out of his mouth is a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh he has this name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I saw an angel standing in the sun who cried out in a loud voice to all the birds flying in midair, Come gather together for the great supper of God, so that you may eat the flesh of kings, generals, and the mighty, of horses and their riders, and the flesh of all people, free and slave, great and small. Then I saw the beast of the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to wage war against the rider on the horse and his army. But the beast was captured, and with it the false prophet who had performed the signs on its behalf. With these signs he had deluded those who had received the mark of the beast and worshipped its image. The two of them were thrown alive into the fiery lake of burning sulfur. The rest were killed with the sword coming out of the mouth of the rider on the horse, and the birds gorged themselves on their flesh. This is the account of Christ's victory. This is the ultimate reason for celebrating Christ's arrival upon the earth, is the promise and the knowledge and the truth that Christ will be victorious over evil. This is a reality that we anticipate. This is something that will be realized in a fuller measure in the future than it is today, but at yet the same time, this is a truth that has been realized in the present age of the church. As we go on to read in Revelation, you'll find that the power of Satan has already been bound by the power of Jesus' name. And the power of Jesus' name belongs to each of God's children in faith. One day before Christ returns, the power of Satan will be released upon the earth in the form of deception. But the victorious events that we just read will be Satan's end and the last of his power forever. And the final scene of our worldly timeline will look like this. I'm going to read from Revelation 20, starting in verse 11. There it says, "Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. And another book was opened, which was the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them, and each person was judged according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire." The lake of fire is the second death. Anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. That is the moment that Revelation has been building up to. In the story of reality, the story that the believers need to know so that they may pursue faithfulness instead of worldliness, the visions have all been leading up to this moment when at the end of history, all the dead are raised and they appear before the throne of God and we are judged. It is the climax of reality. The world's terminal reality is judgment before the throne of God. What we read next is the very reason that John was given this vision. It was the very reason this letter was sent to the seven churches in the province of Asia. The angel has taken John through this vision after vision of just phantasmagorical and crazy, wild things that he has seen to tell and retell this truer, higher story about the reality of heaven so that he can deliver something important, something crucial, something desperate that comes here at the end of the book. An ultimatum. The revelation of John is about drawing a brilliant and unignorable line in the sand. This is an ultimatum to be counted among those who will receive God's blessing, or else those who will be counted among those who receive wrath from God. Hear the terms of the ultimatum. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband, and I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.' He was seated on the throne, said, 'I am making everything new.' Then he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' He said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. to those who are victorious, they will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters, and all liars, they will be consigned to the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. There it is. An ultimatum. It gets repeated as the book concludes, as you read on to the end of Revelation. John gets to see the reality of God's new creation, the reality of the new Jerusalem, the heaven. He gets to see it in greater detail and describes it in even more magnificent language than what we had just read from the beginning of Revelation 21. We are told about what kind of people will inhabit that place of blessing for all eternity, heaven made by God. Those who occupy the New Jerusalem are only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And as the book of Revelation comes to a close in chapter 22, the ultimatum is repeated. I'll be reading from chapter 22, starting in verse 12. There it says, this is Christ speaking. He says, "Look, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, and I will give to each person according to what they have done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes, that they might have the right to the tree of life, and may go through the gates into the city. Outside are the dogs, those who practice magic arts, the sexually immoral, the murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give you this testimony for the churches. I am the root and offspring of David and the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, 'Come.' And let the one who hears say, 'Come.' Let the one who is thirsty come, and let the one who wishes take the free gift of the water of life." What an invitation. Everything that John has seen, everything that the angel and God has shown John there on the island of Patmos leads to this moment. It is a preamble for the delivery of this message, an ultimatum. That in the end, we will receive God's blessing or his damnation. There are those who will experience bliss in the presence of God and those who will be cast out from the presence of God. And the invitation which the Spirit and the bride offer is to come and receive blessing. If you've not given your life to Jesus, then the choice here is made very clear. Do so, or you will suffer eternal damnation. For those who do not belong to Christ, their future reality is hell. It is only through Christ, what he has done for us on the cross, the shedding of his blood, that the penalty of our sins can be taken away and we can be redeemed. The Bible tells us things to do in response to God's gift. It tells us to confess Jesus Christ as Lord. It tells us to repent of our sins. It tells us to believe in Jesus Christ. It tells us to be baptized. In fact, a lot of the imagery that we encounter here in the end of Revelation, where it tells us to be washed, to have our clothes washed, to receive the water of life, is imagery connected to the sacrament of baptism by Jesus with his conversation with Nicodemus in John 4. Or what we read about baptism is its connection to the crucifixion of Christ in Colossians 2 and Romans 6. If you haven't given your life to Jesus and been obedient to his command to be baptized, then do so. Do so that you may be counted among the redeemed and the promises and blessings described here at the end of Revelation can be yours. If you've already made that decision and your life has been given to Christ, then I have something important to tell you. Revelation was not written to unbelievers. The ultimatum that we just read was not delivered to the unchurched. Revelation was written to Christians who were being opposed by their culture and society and were having a hard time choosing righteousness over worldliness. John has shown us how brilliant and majestic the blessings of God are. It started in chapters 4 and 5 when he had this incredible vision of the throne room of God and the Lamb who was able to open the seals and the praise they received by their attendees in heaven. It continues now as John observes and views and describes to us the majestic reality of heaven, God's new creation. But at the same time, all through the book, it has been revealed to John that the world and the forces behind it are hideous and evil. They are described as vile and profane horses that go throughout the world to wield the power of war, the power of economy, the power of death. Furthermore, they are depicted as beasts. Beasts which represent the kingdoms of the world and try to persecute the faithful, to tear them away from belief, to tear them away from their Savior, from His protection. All through Revelation, we are shown how ugly the forces of the world are. There can be no excuse for thinking that the world is your friend when you're done reading this book. Upon the forces behind the world, the horses and beasts that we read of, God's wrath is upon them, as we've already read this morning. Christ, through John in Revelation, is desperate for the believers in the province of Asia to know this. He's desperate for them to realize that what they're encountering in the world and the forces which are trying to tear them away from their faith or to get them to not practice a life of righteousness in Jesus, he's desperate for them to know what that reality is. He's desperate for them to choose righteousness over worldliness, to walk in a path obedient to Christ, not obedient to the way the world wanted them to live, to the way their first century Roman society wanted them to live and the kinds of expectations that society had for them. He's desperate enough to deliver an ultimatum and say that on this side of the line is blessing, but on that side of the line is damnation. In the battle between darkness and light, you must choose a side. So my invitation to the redeemed in this room, if you belong to Jesus Christ, is to reject and expel the way of the world. The way the world has expectations for your behavior, the way the world defines your life's goals, what you value, and the world's temptations. Even though we can often get tricked into believing that the world is our friend, behind the forces of the world are profane and insidious beasts. And the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters and all liars, they will be consigned to the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. Instead, come. The words of Christ in Revelation end with an invitation for the believers who he is writing to in the province of Asia to come to Jesus, to be faithful to him, to choose the way of light and life over the world of darkness and death. The invitation is to come. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. Let the one who is thirsty come. And let the one who wishes to take the free gift of the water of life come. Join me in prayer. Dear God, give us the wisdom and the eyes to see the difference between light and darkness. Dear God, fill us with our spirit so that we may reject the way of the world, the way of death, so that we may see the world and the forces of evil for what they are, as beasts who oppose your kingdom and your rule, as beasts who try to tear us away from faithfulness in your Son. Dear God, we celebrate and we welcome the coming victory of Jesus over the evil of this world. Dear God, because we have forgiveness in your Son, because we're filled with your Spirit, we experience joy at the thought of your return. Dear Heavenly Father, help us to choose wisely and live in such a way that we receive your blessing and not damnation. Praise in your name. Amen.
Would you stand as we close today?
Joy to the world.